Are you ready to play with the new node? Let's jump into Houdini 19 and check it out.
Secondary motion. I love using KineFX. It makes rigging objects super fast and easy. It's definitely not limited to characters either. And now in Houdini 19, we have this incredibly awesome node called secondary motion, which adds beautiful organic secondary motion for free with only a few clicks. So let's dive in and take a look at this powerhouse of a node. Here, I have a very basic setup to demonstrate how to set this node up. It's not a drop and go node, as you have to configure some things in order for it to do something. In this simple scene, I have a line with 3 points. I then use a rig doctor to initialize transforms and the name attribute that KineFX needs to do its magic. I'm then using a rig pose to animate a single joint. I'm then using a small expression to rotate it back and forth at an 80 degree angle. I'll do a transform and move it over to the side so that we have a reference of our original motion. Now I can drop down the secondary motion node on a separate stream. By default, this doesn't do anything. This is because we need to set up the joint group and the source group. These can be a bit confusing. The source joint group is the single point from which to read the animation from. The joint group is the group that you want to affect with the secondary motion. As we only have incoming animation on point one, we'll leave that as the source, but we can change the joint group and see the difference that it makes. If we add another point to our line, we can further demonstrate what is happening here. We can continue to reference the animation on one point, but we can affect one or more of the other points with the secondary motion node. Of course, this being KineFX, we can capture some geometry and use this curve to animate it. Amazing. You can also stack secondary motion nodes and increase the amount so certain joints get more secondary motion, like the pig ears. When we have a lot of incoming points, such as this animation driven by a simple rig attribute wrangle, we can use an expression such as the asterisk to say affect all groups based on the animation of the last point. Or we can use an exclamation before the point and use everything but that point. So now point 20 won't be affected, but all the rest will. We can also use the selection arrow to draw in the viewport to select the joints that we want to affect. Moving on, by default, this node is set to work on the local transforms created by KineFX. However, we can change this mode to other attribute and it'll work on any attribute that you specify. The default here is P, so it'll work on the position of the points or joints and apply secondary motion to that. You can specify your own attribute if you want to store these transforms on an external attribute for later use. You can also use the configuration attribute and use a configure joint to constrain your rig to not move past certain limits that you specify. Here I've told each joint not to move more than 15 degrees in each direction. You can see that it limits the movement when it approaches the angle limit that you set. This is obviously very important when your main movement is extreme but you want to limit the secondary movement. This node has 3 effect types, lag and overshoot, jiggle and spring. Lag and overshoot will lag the motion or overshoot, pretty mind-blowing really. The first value affects the rise in velocity and the second value the decrease in velocity. This basically means that it'll affect the forward movement and the backward movement of objects. You can also use the scale by attribute function on each of these parameters. This lets you assign different values to different sections. In this case, I'm using my curve view attribute and I'm remapping it. Now I get this really cool jiggle behavior. The jiggle mode adds some fun jiggle to your animation. The stiffness is how closely it should follow the original animation. Higher values means more stiffness and be more like the original. The limit is how far points can stray from the original data. Smaller values will keep the object quite constrained, giving it just a little bit of movement. In my simple tests, the other parameters do not make a big change in the animation. However, it's worth trying them out in your animations. The help card explains what they do really well. Finally, you get the spring mode. This adds a vibration effect as if your object is attached to a giant spring. The spring constant is how strong the spring is. Higher numbers means smaller vibrations. Lower numbers means bigger vibrations. The mass is how heavy the object is at the end of the spring. So higher values will produce short vibrations and have higher amplitudes. Higher mass also needs higher damping or it'll vibrate forever. Damping is the amount of resistance. So higher values will kill the secondary movement more quickly. Mixing these values and scaling by attribute can get some super fun results with very little effort. The gravity tab tries to emulate gravity while doing the secondary motion. This helps objects be a little more controlled and feel more weighted. You can specify the joint that you want to apply gravity to. You then select the correct lookat values, which depend on the orientation of your joints. Lastly, we have the blend function. This lets you blend between the original motion and your secondary motion. You can also set the blend type to ease it in. You can then specify the frame ranges to blend into the secondary motion and also out of the secondary motion. This helps when you only want secondary motion for a specific section of your animation. This node is amazing and gives you so many organic motions for free. It's definitely worth looking into as it can breathe some amazing life into your animations with just a few clicks. Now it's time to open Houdini and give it a try. It's Houdini time.